quickly. You're all familiar with creative interchange, right? Yeah. You've heard it from Mr. Johan Roos a number of times. Is that correct?
Yes.
So I'm going to go through this very quickly. This is what we learned from Henry Nelson Wyman, going all the way back to roughly 1915, when he had what we would sometimes call today an epiphany. When he had a giant aha, he saw something. I would argue that what he saw is at the very heart of who we are. So very quickly, he talked about interacting with other people. One of the words I added to that as a result of work with Accenture and Motorola and Sprint and Microsoft and some of those companies is another word that I'm sure you may call it genuine, you may call it real, you may call it, I don't know what you call it, you got your own words for it, but what I'm talking about here is authenticity, being who you really are. But how can you be really who you are if you haven't been monitoring your self-talk? You see, most people think they are what their self-talk is saying. It's part of who you are. Part of who you are. But it's not the rest of you. And when we talk authentic here, we mean all of you is present to the situation. We'll talk more about that as we go. So it's not just interacting as we've been socially trained to interact. It's talking about a deeper level, more open, honest, trusting relationship. Second of all, we're talking not just about understanding, but Wyman added this term early on, appreciative understanding. If you bought your teenager a new BMW when they were first of age to drive an automobile, what did they think about what you gave them? Do they, quote, appreciate your gift? You think?
I hope so.
Yes.
After you put out all that money, you ungrateful kid. Anyway, but here's what I want to add to the word appreciation. In the United States, we would say if it's a boy, we call it the boys, one of the boys' concerns about driving this new sports car is what we call a chick magnet. It attracts the opposite sex, you know. And I feel stronger. Why? Because I'm driving this car. I'm a better looking guy. I'm stronger. I'm better this, better that. Look at that. And when we get to a red light and it turns green, whoo, I'm the fastest guy on the street. Nobody else has got a car like mine. That is true. They are, quote, appreciating the car. But true appreciation, as we mean it here, is that I also appreciate that it is a lethal weapon. That it can not only kill me, it can maim and hurt other people. It can cause a great deal of financial indebtedness, a variety of other things. To appreciate the value of something is to have a full-scale appreciation of getting back to what we talked about earlier. Is it all good? No. Is it all bad? No. Does it have some of both as potential? Yes. And so when you offer me a new idea, if I appreciatively understand it, I either don't just jump all over and say, well, that's the greatest idea. Why? Because it agrees with my thinking. Or that idea is absolutely terrible. No, it has some elements in it that way, but it has other elements. If I really appreciate, I have some distance. And we'll look at that more, again, as part of an exercise to see that you can find positive and negative in literally anything. Any idea, any situation. But you'll find that you tend to polarize. I really like this situation, but that is a total disaster. And the issue is, has there ever been a time in your life when you thought it was the worst thing that has ever happened to you, but maybe months or a few years later, you look back on it and you recognize it was the greatest thing that ever happened to me? You ever had that? So what was it when it happened? Was it good or was it bad? Well, I may have not seen the other side of the picture, because I'm sure you've had the other happen too. You thought, man, this is the greatest thing since sliced bread, and only discovered after the fact, I can't believe I was so stupid that I did that at the time. Yes, sir.
Charlie, is there, I fully agree with that polarization and that dichotomous thinking. Is there a link with a particular area of the brain? Because I've understood that the brain has got, we've got a primal, more reptile brain, the amygdala and so on, and then we've got a the limbic system, and then the neocortex. Is there a link with certain areas in of that?
You mean, do we register when you're doing that in your head? Yes.
Yeah.
Did you want more?
Yeah. I mean, out of neuroscience and so on, is there
evidence
that when people are actually in that polarization?
Well, think about that you're either on expansion mode to a large extent or protection mode.
Yeah.
And we know that if you have a span of observation and you start to get tense and you think there might be a threat, it immediately begins to narrow and it becomes the primary focus. And when you're stressed out like that, all this potential that might have been there is now gone. You do not make connections to that part of your brain, so that by becoming stressed out, you already became a poor problem solver. You may become a more alert, working on one little element of the idea, but if we need creative answers, you're not the person to ask. Your creativity has been narrowed drastically because you're watching out to see how do I stay safe in this situation.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm ready to fight you, flee from you, or I get immobilized and I don't know what to do with you. And that, when you're immobilized, think about it as simply, I don't know whether to run or to fight. And so I basically just sort of sit there and mumble because I'm not sure what to do. So if we keep those three modes in mind, so once you become more protected, but we're going to look at perception later, that we see one way and we observe another way, but it's our observation that we don't do very well anymore, even though scientifically we talk about it. The first part, to what degree are we authentically exchanging the best we now know, our best information? To what degree am I trying to appreciate the whole continuum of what you're talking about, and I don't just have a knee-jerk idea and say, oh, can't believe he or she thinks that. That is really dumb. Appreciative understanding means I'm monitoring and asking myself, you obviously see value in it. I obviously do not see value in it. That's as much a statement about me as it is about you. And so all we're saying is in creative interchange, before you want to jump all over what's wrong with someone else's idea, take some time to discover what's valuable about it to them. Because if you attack, if your first thing is, oh, that is, I've heard some dumb ideas, but that one sets a whole new record, guess what they're going to do? They're not going to respond positively to what you've got to say. In other words, they're going to return the favor. You mess with my idea, well, I'll go ahead and mess with yours. Provided they're smaller than you. If they're bigger than you, then you go into hiding and say, yeah, you're right. I guess that wasn't such a good idea after all. So you sell yourself out. So we're looking at ways to take your ideas and my ideas and put them together in a way, and this is the synergy package, that your idea plus my idea can equal a better idea than either one of us has in our head at any given moment. But if you look at a polarized situation, you'll see that one or both of the parties or whoever's involved is each arguing for the fact their position is better. which means they're clearly aware of the positives on their side, but highly alert to the negatives on your side. If, on the other hand, you're highly aware of your positives and highly aware of their negatives, then the more we lock in, the more polarized the situation. We're trying to teach that to our politicians. You think they're doing a good job? And then finally, if we begin to put our stuff together, we can mutually, basically, learn. From you, I see it a way I could not see it before I took the time to appreciatively understand what you were saying. And then a little aha button goes on the creative part, and I say, oh, you ever had that situation? You're in a conversation, you're not understanding, and all of a sudden you get that click, and you suddenly see it. And it's sort of like, ah, okay, I see it. That's a good feeling. And incidentally, you can have more of those feelings if you choose to. I've got to watch that. I lost the back to my equipment here. I'm technologically challenged. This is creative interchange. Interact, appreciatively understand yourself and others, creatively integrating the differences to discover things that are new. As we used to talk about, I think you might have used this in your introduction, that even a midget sees further than the giant if you sit on their shoulders. Okay? So that's part of what I want us to think about. This is creative interchange. Not just one of these circles, but the combination of all four happening, and they can all happen within a matter of seconds. And the better you get at being open and trusting and listening positively, the faster you see things in other people's ideas you hadn't thought of, and you even like them. As opposed to, my job is to prove to you I'm as smart as you are. Big deal. If you're not smarter than me, you already have my sympathy. Okay? Comments, questions? Is this familiar ground? I mean, I think you've all been over it. Right? Good. We're moving on. So, it's Keegan and LaHaye talk about in their book a thing called a blind spot. Okay, that's where in my perception of me, I'm blind in terms of how I perceive a given situation. And so what they talk about is that find your blind spot in order to start what? Learning. You can't learn through your blind spot if you don't know it's there. So you just remain blind to it while you go on doing something. The issue is, what you have to be willing to do is to examine your vulnerabilities. Fear of vulnerability or humility is the critical barrier. It is the basis for why we hide. I don't want to be seen as vulnerable. And we've all been educated to be fearful when we think we're about to be. So here's some questions for your table to take a few moments. You can pick any one of these or all of these. Do you have a blind spot? Now, you could say intellectually, yeah, I've got one, but it doesn't help me. In other words, would you want to know it? Or are you content to remain blind? Don't tell me that I got a blind spot. I'm fat, dumb, and happy. If you wouldn't want to know your blind spot, why not? Look at whatever fear may be there that says, I wouldn't want that pointed out. I wouldn't want you to know. Or what is your blind spot? You may be already there and you're able to share it at your table, right? All of you will love your neighbors regardless of how vulnerable they are, won't you? Or will you say, oh, giddy, we got one, we can just tear him apart. He is so weak and vulnerable. Are you willing to be vulnerable and share it? And that's part of what's coming out as a new way to run a culture. If we go back to what you said, once I've got the position, I don't want them to see me sweat. I'm up here because I'm better than you. I'm the right person for the job. Far be it for me to show I'm vulnerable. What it is absolutely incredible for most people to believe, if you were able to show your vulnerability, you would have more credibility with the people who know you. They know you're vulnerable. What they feel is, you're not smart enough to know your own vulnerabilities, you arrogant fool. But they're not going to tell you that because you signed their paycheck. And that's part of the hidden costs that we run into over and over. So take some time right now at your table. Share your blind spots if you know them. If you don't, the others at the table will be more than glad to tell you what they are.